by this choir. Special thanks to Ese of Voronye. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to International Oil of Radio. Stand up. Don't sit down. Don't sit down. When they will take third service time, you don't complain. Because you see, all these things you're doing that time. Man of God, I thank God now you. You are not a stranger. This is heaven come for you. Many of you will remember his face. Pastor Kato, Bishop. It's my old name, eh?
Yeah, correct.
Bishop Henry Jero. Is a man anointed by God uniquely. Now listen to me. He may not make you shout, but he will inject you. Meaning he's here to cure. He will drop the word that you will run with. He know me more than I know myself. The day they set me out, he was there. You know, huge time, he was there. And it's one man I can't quite give. Listen, gentlemen, I can't introduce him. But I want you to welcome my own elder brother, Bishop Harry.
If you're happy, can you please shout hallelujah?
Hallelujah!
Can you please shout hallelujah?
Hallelujah!
For a season of encounter, can you shout hallelujah?
Hallelujah!
If you believe that the Lord will cause a change in your life, can you shout hallelujah?
Hallelujah!
Bishop, this choir, I can see some, the excitement in their life is so contagious. Yeah! Let me take picture with them. Make I take photo with them. Make I come. It's not contagious. But just because it's my brother, amen. Somebody you have known for about 30 years is your brother. That's the truth. It's very truth. And the person has been consistent is a brother. Is somebody with me? You will get to know maybe in the next service why you when you call somebody your brother, you will get to know about that. It's not just, you see, when I say you are my brother, you are my sister, it means a lot. It connotes so much. It is beyond just mere words. I have known him for upward of about 30 years, so it's not for joke. Amen. It's not for joke. So whatever ups and downs he have gone through, I know. Is somebody with me? Whatever ups and downs he have gone through, I know. Whether for good or for bad, whether for praise or not for praise, whether by rumor or not by rumor, whatever ups and downs he has gone through, I do what? I know. Tell somebody, say, you know. Is somebody with me?
Yes, sir.
But God sent me this morning for somebody.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah.
Are you that person?
Yes, sir.
Your amen will be louder than your neighbor's own.
Amen.
So God sent me for somebody this morning.
Yes, sir.
Like he told you, I may not make you to shout. You may not scream. But God has come to vaccinate somebody.
Yes, sir.
Is somebody hearing that?
Yes, sir.
God has come to vaccinate somebody. God has come to immunize somebody.
Amen.
God has come to immunize somebody.
Amen.
And you will never remain the same again.
Amen.
God is about to raise somebody's spiritual thermometer up.
Amen.
God is about to raise somebody's value system up.
Amen.
is about to deepen somebody's commitment.
Amen.
Deepen somebody's commitment.
Amen.
Not to the world, but unto Yahweh.
Amen.
Is that person here?
Yes, sir.
Is the person here?
Yes, sir.
Is the person here?
Yes, sir.
Is the person here?
Yes, sir.
Tomorrow it will be a slightly different ball game.
Yes, sir.
Tomorrow evening it will be a slightly different ball game. Today we are laying a foundation to deepen your Christianity. Because when God caused the miracle to come, God needs a foundation.
Yes, sir.
To sustain it. Without that foundation, you see, when the foundation be destroyed, what can what?
Let us do.
Tomorrow is a different ball game. I will not teach according to your expectation tomorrow, but I want you to understand that tomorrow, if there is anybody that is sick, come with the person. If there's anybody that is trusting God for the fruit of the womb, come with a person. You see, by God's grace, I am privileged to experience healing experientially. I'm not just talking story. Experientially. And if I experience healing experientially, I want to pass it across to somebody. This man you see here suffered from kidney failure. Was in dialysis. But God brought him out. And today I can tell you, there is no injection, there is no tablet, there is no medication whatsoever, and he's keep standing, and I'll keep standing. So that man can tell you about what? Healing.
Yes, sir.
But that is not for today. Is somebody hearing me? Today we want to talk, amen?
Amen.
Let's deepen our Christianity a little bit, amen?
Amen.
That's what God wants to do for somebody today.
Amen.
And God will deepen your Christianity.
Amen.
Because when I was in the dialysis bed, I'll be honest with you. I asked God, God, why am I here? Why am I here? Why am I on dialysis? Why am I going through this? I asked God. And some of you have asked God similar questions before. But tomorrow is your night.
Amen.
There are a whole lot to do tomorrow, man of God. So we will start early, amen?
Amen.
So come on time. Come on time, but tomorrow let's lay foundation to deepen our Christianity. Is that all right with you?
Yes, sir.
I want to sincerely thank the protocol team and thank. I'm seeing so many beautiful people. Are they creatures or ushers on black? Wonderful people. Every one of you. You see, some of you here, you celebrate yourself. Celebrate yourself. Celebrate yourself. Some of you here, all those of you who have gray hair like me, your power doesn't get. I celebrate you. For holding on, I celebrate you. For every one of you who have been here to be committed to this commission, to be committed to what God is doing here, the Lord bless you.
Amen.
The Lord bless you.
Amen.
He mentioned a name now, Essie. I think that name is ringing in my ears. Essie, it's like I've met her before. Yeah, I met her before. Essie, you see, hear this real well. The Lord said, I don't forget the labor of love. It may look as though it is forgotten, but he said, I don't forget the labor of love.
He said,
the God of loyalty.
Yes, sir.
And the God of commitment.
Yes.
And the God of sacrifice.
Yes.
If I be that God, I say, yeah, and hear me really well. He said, if I be that God, your reward is imminent.
Amen.
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 The Lord said, he said, in the face of rumors and all kind of bashing, he said, you have remained committed. He said, hear me, I hear me really well. He said, if I be the God of covenants, Rakindu Satayabasa. If I be the God of covenant keepers, your reward is not far. You, I know you have asked, which was God, for how much longer will I wait? For how much longer will I wait? You have asked God questions. The Lord said, you have asked me questions. And your questions have come up unto me. But I say, the Lord is saying this morning, he said, the time for those answers are now.
Amen.
Now. 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 In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I said the Lord will hasten his word to perform them.
Yes, sir.
The era of tears, painful tears are over. It is time for the tears of joy now.
Amen.
It is time. Is it not time for the tears of joy? That is the question I'm asking you. It is the time for the tears of joy.
Amen.
It is the time for surprises from God.
Amen.
This is the time. This is your season.
Amen.
It 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 is your season.
Amen.
If you believe that we have, shout amen.
Amen.
Amen with us.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Please tell your neighbor you are welcome to the season of greatness.
The season of greatness.
The oil of greatness shall rest upon you. Do you believe it? Because I do. God bless you. Have your wonderful celebrated seat this morning. God bless you. Please sit down. Please sit down. Oh, Libras Keto Hilabakanda.
Hallelujah.
Our time is fast spent. Don't worry. We'll just take small dose now. We'll continue the third service and let's see how we continue. Amen. Jehovah, it is your time to speak to us. It is not about me. It's about what you said I should say. So let it be you that is speaking to your children. Let it be you that is speaking to your children, not me. They will not look at me because they want to hear from you. Let my tongue this morning be like the tongue of the pen of the ready writer to minister grace to your children. To minister grace to your children. To minister grace to your children. Father, Lord, I thank you. I give you praise.
Thank you, Lord.
I give you glory.
Thank you, Father.
May your name be glorified this morning.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
We are going to look at the scripture in Philippians chapter 2. We'll take a little bit of a long read from verse 19. And then we'll look at the pictures that Apostle Paul is trying to create there. If you have NIV, can you please give us NIV, if you have NIV? Or if you don't have, no problem. Oh, good. Wonderful. I'll take the first one, and you take the second one. Are we ready for that? I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be shared when I receive news about you.
I have no one else like him. Who takes a genuine interest in your welfare?
For everyone looks out for his own interests, not those of Jesus Christ.
But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel.
Next verse quickly. I hope, therefore, to send him as soon as I see how things go with me.
And I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon.
But I think it is necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, who you sent to take care of my word, my
needs. For he longs for all of you, and is distressed because you heard he was ill.
Look at next verse. Indeed, he was ill and almost died. But God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon what?
Sorrow. Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad that I may have less anxiety.
Welcome him in the Lord with great joy, and honor men like him.
Because he almost died for the work of Christ, risking his life to make up for the help you could not give me.
May this be our story in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You may not have the full understanding of what God is saying here, but if you can catch the glimpse of what God is saying here, then you will know whether your Christianity is still shadow or it is deepened. You will know. Please sit down. When God gave me this word, as I was coming, he said, go and deepen the relationship of my children. It is not time to shout. It is not time for the miracles will come, but deepen their relationship with me. That is what is important. And that is what God is saying to somebody this morning. For those of us who are writing, if you have to title it, God is looking for people of value. People of value. People will add value to what God is doing. God is looking for people that will add value. Men of value, women of value, children of value. God is looking for men who will value relationship before profits. God is looking for people who will value relationship before profits, before results. Everything is not about profit. Everything is not about results. God is looking for people like you and I who we esteem relationship above profits. I'm sure that could be one of the reasons why God spoke to Esther this morning. She must have valued the relationship she had with God and with Bishop over time above any other thing that happens to her. Many of us, we are result-oriented, including myself as men. But the Lord is saying, everything is not about result. Everything is not about profit. Have you been told by somebody before that, look, I'm selling this thing to you at this price because I know you, and only for you to discover that the same person I've what ripped you off? Hello? Anybody like that here? They don't want to you. They don't want to you. Okay. That person values what? Profit above what? Relationship. And the Lord is looking for people who will value relationship above what? Profits. The profit will come. But if relationship is sustained, the profit will keep reoccurring. Because there will be referrals. But if you read me off, today, and I got to know, tomorrow I may not branch your shop. Have you taken your handset to somebody to repair? You repair the same handset today, tomorrow you are back. Repair today, tomorrow you are back. Have you noticed that before? And then the person will be charging you, let's say, $2,000 for the repair. Tomorrow anytime you come, oh, it's a charging port. Oh, next time it is that. And you took the same handset to somebody else. You didn't even spend $2,000. You spent just 500 naira. And for the next 6 months, that handset is still working. People have valued relationship. But people also value what? Profits. But this morning, the Lord is saying, value relationship above what? Profits. And God is looking for you. Tell somebody, God is looking for you to value relationship above profits, above results. Let me tell you, profits don't last forever, but people will last forever. People have internal value. Profits don't have internal value. Profits don't have internal value, but people have internal value. So profit don't last forever, but people last forever. Is somebody hearing me? In verse 20, where we read. In verse 20, where we read together. Let's see verse 20 that we read. Can we please go back to that? Okay. He said, I have no one else like him. I have no one else like him. Can you imagine that? You can imagine, let's say, Iji, Bishop crying and say, look, Henry, I have looked around. I have no one else like this guy. He's the only one. He might try us. He might travel. He might over there. Only one stood by me. Can that be your story? Can that be your story? Apostle Paul was crying. I have no one else like him who takes what? Genuine interest in your welfare. Not forced interest because of what I will get from you. And it looks as if I have interest in you. Because of your money, it looks as if I have interest in you. Because of what I want, it looks as if I have interest in you. But Apostle Paul is saying that has genuine what? Interest. Is that person here? Could that be talking about me? Could that be talking about you? I told you, God said, go and deepen the relationship of my children. That's what God said I should come and do. And if that one is achieved, even the life of one person this morning, this conference is a word, it's a success. If one person, relationship with God can be deepened this morning, this success, this conference is a word, it's a success. Even your immediate family, or people around you, let me ask, do they see you that you are only consumed by your business, consumed by your job, consumed by things, that you don't have genuine interest in them? Do your spouse see you that you don't have genuine interest in her or him? How do they see you? How do your immediate family even value you? How do they see you? What value system can they place upon your head? When you are not there, what will they say about you? What will they say about you? I have not come to excite you this morning. I have come to drop what God said I should drop. So listen attentively and be changed. Because God is speaking to somebody. God is looking for people who are not afraid to stand alone for what is right. He's looking for men and women who are not afraid to stand for what is right. I don't care what others are saying, but as long as it is right, I will do the right thing. I don't care the pressure in my office, everybody is still here and there. I don't care, I will do what is what? Right. I don't care what Brother A, Brother B is doing in church. I will do what is what?
Right.
Even if people around me are committing fornication, that's not my problem. I will do what is what?
Right.
Even if men around me are committing adultery, I will do what is what?
Right.
God is looking for people who are not afraid to stand alone for what is right. This is character. Because in verse 22, where we read, the scripture says, quickly, let's see verse 22. The scripture says something that I want to understand and to go home with. But you know that Timothy has proved himself. Yeah, he has been tried. He has been tested. In and out, and he remained what?
Consistent.
He has proved himself. As far as conviction about doing what is right is concerned, Timothy is standing firm. If you don't stand for something, somebody say, you will fall for what? Anything. The reason Let me honest with you. The reason the average Muslim regime, when they are in power, especially the national level, the reason we feel as if we are being oppressed is because they have a conviction. But put a Christian president there. Now, in our water. So why are we complaining? Have our people not been there before? Have our people not been there before? What did they do? Flexible, like water. No conviction. A man of character, a man of conviction, is ready to die for what he believes. That's what the average Muslim can kill without looking back. What are your convictions? Are you standing firm for God? Are you ready to stand alone in spite of? Our leader, our people have been there before. You can begin to name our certain president that claim to be Christians. They have been there before. Not one, not two, not three. When my brother, good luck, Jonathan was there, what did he do? Under his nose, what is his name? Obasanjo have moved all the oil offices to where? To Lagos and Abuja, to the west. And under his nose, for 6 good years, did he do anything? He can't do any shit. No conviction. And we are complaining. They are oppressing us. Your brother and my sister have been there before. What do they know how to do to use billions of naira to buy jewelries? Hello? Make I put you there now. Smother your song, your language won't begin. You know. You see, this is a democracy. You know. You have to favor. You have to favor the people. And you know. Hello? That time, you know. Put me there. My language goes straight to what? You know. By that time, I go forget whether I come from Umuahia. I go forget whether I come from Rivers. I go forget whether I come from Delta. If not, how dare Jonathan, who came from an impoverished area, deprived area, go there and forgot about Abuja. I forgot about Niger Delta. How dare? It is you know. We are complaining. What are we complaining about? When people complain, I just laugh. What are we complaining about? What are we complaining about? Yoruba man has been there. Igbo man has been there. Ijo man has been there. What did they do? If not for Yeradua, we would have even been suffering more than now. I'm telling you the truth. You know, become our language. Put any one of us there. Because as Christians, we don't seem to have strong character. We are so weak when it comes to standing for our conviction. A man of conviction is ready to die for what he believes. That was what Timothy was to who? To Paul. He said, look, but you know, it's not the same. He said, but you know. That is, you who know him. That what? He has proved himself. Can God hit him chest and declare before his brethren here? Oh, Henry, you people know. Henry has what? Proved himself. Oh, you people know. Grace have what? Proved herself. Oh, you people know. Ungozi have what? Proved herself. Can God knock his chest on your behalf? Only you will be able to say that. Only you can say that. I may not be able to say that for you. Is my private life consistent with my public life? I said, God is looking for people who are not afraid to stand alone for what is what? Right. Is my private life consistent with
my public life. Inconsistent parents produces inconsistent children. That's why most of our children are so inconsistent. They are so like this. Because the children learn from us. We are saying the youth of today, where did they learn it from? Are they not our product? Are we not the one that gave birth to them? We gave birth to them, man of God. They are our product. Inconsistent parents, without values, without conviction of character, we always produce inconsistent word, children. It's not far. The apple does not fall far from the word, from the tree. It's always close by. It's not far, it's close by. It's not far, my dear. Unreliable spouses, we produce unstable marriages. It could be the one that is unreliable, or it could be the two that's unreliable. But once one is unreliable, once one is not trusted, then we always produce unreliable word, marriage. Am I talking to somebody? It takes just one to be unreliable. It takes just one to be undependable. It takes just one, and that marriage becomes what? Shaky. Am I talking to somebody this morning? God is looking for people who will cooperate with one another. He's looking for people who will cooperate with one another. Even the Trinity work together. Why do you want to walk alone? Why do you want to be alone? You can't be a lone ranger. Even the Trinity said, let us. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit said, let us. They can walk alone, but he said, no, let's cooperate. Let us. Your idea is great. My idea is great. But when we put the two great ideas together, it's a bomb. God is looking for people that will cooperate with one another. Can't you say that you're cooperating? Even the ministry that you belong to, whether in the choir or in the orchestra or in the usher department or whatever the ministry you belong to, will your leader see that you are cooperating with him or her? Can they count on you? Can your leader count on your cooperation? Can the head of protocol count on his members? That I know, if nobody is there, this person will be there. Can they count on you? Are you so unreliable? Do you not cooperate? You are so occupied with what you are doing, occupied with your business, occupied with your job. Great. There's nothing wrong with that. But the Lord is looking for people who will cooperate with one another. God is saying, don't just throw into the house of God. Don't just throw into my house. Sit down, soak, and go. God is saying, don't do that. You need to cooperate with my children. Because you will see it, maybe, I hope in the next service, you need to cooperate with my children. Without that cooperation, you have not deepened your Christianity. You are standing alone. You say, but is it the scripture? Look at verse 25. Look at verse 25. We don't have time, so we are jumping. Let's see this in verse 25. Say, but I think it is necessary to send back to you who? Epaphroditus. Why? It's my what? My what? Fellow what? And what? I told you when I was talking about our bishop, I said, he is my brother. We have known for quite a long time. Let's go natural. When you introduce somebody as your brother, what are you trying to tell me? This is my family world member. Have you not been so? When you say somebody is your sister, what are you trying to say? We are related. We are related. We are kinsmen. Am I correct? That is the same expectation in scripture. When you call somebody your brother in scripture, you are simply saying that we are what? Related. We are blood related. We are blood related. We are related. He said, my brother. Hear me, I hear me everywhere. It is a church family that Apostle Paul is trying to describe here. It is what? A church family. We are relatives. Forget about my title. I'm your brother. Am I right? Forget about, primarily, first and foremost, I'm your what? I'm your brother. Forget about the title. Forget about the bishop. When he called just now, it looked like one big thing. I am Brother Henry, first and foremost. Hello? Is somebody with me? I repeat, I said, I am Brother what? Henry. Primary. First thing first. First thing first. That is a primary. That one is primary. So if you are my brother, if you are my sister, then it also means that if we are family, for family to be thick, for family to be something else, it also means that everybody must what? Play his part. Am I right? If they call family meeting, nobody sees you. A time will come when they will begin to ignore you. Am I correct? No, is somebody hearing me? Am I talking to somebody? If they call family meeting and nobody, you don't respond to anything, nobody seems to, no, you don't, nothing. A time will come, they will begin to do what? Ignore you. Because to them, you are no longer, you are in fact, you are no longer what? Part of what? Family. But it will only, it's a church family. Remember, I said it's a church family, eh? But hear this. It will only become a family to you if you get involved. It's your involvement that will make it to become what? A family to you. If you are not involved, it is not yet a family to you. If you just stroll in and stroll out, it is not yet what? A family. That's why some of us will complain. I have not been in church for about 2 weeks and nobody even noticed it. I have not been in church for about a month. Nobody called me. Nobody visited me. How will they visit you when they don't know you? Do they see you as a family member? Do they see you as a family member? Can they count on you that you are a member of this family? Can they count on you? The ministry that you even belong to, let's even assume you belong to a ministry. Do they count on you that truly this person is a member of this family? Can your leader stand at ground or his ground to say, yes, this person is a member? When you stroll in and stroll out, family, it becomes only a family if and only if you get what? Involved. If you're not involved, it is not yet what? A family to you. Is there anybody who is a family member of this great church? Treat it as a family. You see, you may not know the impact of a family till you are in crisis. For you, I'm telling you, is somebody hearing me? You may not know the impact of a family till you are in crisis. When we are in crisis, at times we have no choice to fall to our natural world, family. When you are in crisis, even as a Christian, it is then you will know that when people, you see, somebody last week was sharing with me. He said, I came to this church because of my wife. My wife was the one who brought me here. He said, but since I came, I have realized something. They had a major crisis. Major crisis. Since I came, I realized that when we are going through this crisis, you will pray for us almost every day. You send money in cash, you call, you visit, and I shocked him. I said, let me shock you. I said, that is happening because you treated Father's house as a world, as a family. You are involved, your wife is involved. I want to encourage, there's no time, we need to close for this. I want to encourage every one of us here, please, treat the church as a what? As a family. I repeat, treat the church as what?
As a family.
That is the only time you will understand
the import of what? Family. If you don't treat it, if you don't get involved, it is not yet a family unto you. Please get involved today. As you get involved, the Lord bless you in Jesus' name. You are here and you want to deepen your relationship with God. You may not need to come out, but you want to deepen your relationship with God. Just lay your right hand on your chest. That's all you need to do. Yes, thank you. Thank you. You want to deepen your relationship with God and also with the children of God. Two things. One, you want to deepen your relationship with God and also with the children of God. Where you are, where you are seated or standing, just lay your right hand on your chest as a mark of say, look, my heart now goes to God and to who? To the children of God. I want to deepen my relationship with God and with the children of God. With the children of God. It won't be just about me again. It will be about the children of God. It won't be about me again. It is not beyond me. It is a family. I see this as a family. I see my brother as my brother. I see it as a family. Say this after me. Say, Lord,
Lord,
from today, forgive me.
Forgive.
Of how I have neglected your family.
Of how I have neglected
your family. I have neglected your family.
I have neglected.
From today, I'm a different person. I will get involved. In your family. In the morning, I will get involved. In the noon, I will get involved. In the evening, I will get involved. Any point in time, I will get involved. I will get involved from today. In Jesus' mighty name. And let somebody say amen with them.
Amen. Amen.